Okay, let's see. Put my hat on. Hey, hat on. And I'm making me a spritzer. As far as I understand, spritzers didn't come out until like the 70s or something like that. I don't think could have before then, you know, but whatever. It's basically wine. I got some white wine here and juice. See, I don't particularly like, I like pineapple juice, but I don't know. I don't really like it straight. I can't explain it. The only juice I really like straight, aside from apple juice, is mango juice. I really like that straight. Everything else is sort of mixed. I'll put this over here. Okay. And I said, well, why are you drinking a spritzer? You know, that's like diluting wines, something like that. Well, drinking a spritzer because I'm going to talk about highbrow stuff here. Compromise. I'm taking juice and wine, compromising. Instead of just juice, it's just wine, I'm compromising, see? Now, I actually took some notes. Hey, Lucy. Hey. My doggy likes to be up my legs and stuff like that. I actually took some notes on this. Oh, here we go. Now, if I could read them, I guess I could read them if I take my shades off. And here's the thing. Okay, let me put my shades back on for this, because this is like my hip talk, you know? Like I know what I'm talking about. Look, with this whole thing, first off, when I say whole thing, I'm talking about election season. Election season here is best about 2 years or more. And some people it's like 4 years. Some people it's like like 16 years. How long has Joe Biden been running for president? I don't know. Anyway, the point really is that to me, I break down the seasons like there's like, say, not polling, because polling is something different, but there's sort of like pre-debate season. You know, that's when all the people jump in. Then you start to have your debates. That's a debate season, right? Then you have actual voting by people who vote, you know? And that would be, you know, well, let's call it the primary season, even though it starts off with a caucus, you know, caucus being Iowa caucus, which is why I have to talk to you now. Then you have the caucus season, the primary season, right? Then you have, you know, the convention, of course. Then you have the election, whatever, for the election part, okay? I just lost my track of how many seasons that was. Anyways, so you have different parts of different seasons. Now, I just want to deal with pre-primary season, which is what we're in exactly right now, because primary started caucus about 2 weeks, something like with Iowa, whatever. Okay, so in this thing, what you're basically doing, you're seeing all the candidates, seeing what their platforms are, and then you say, ooh, then you made them, ooh, if this would with this, and you match with that. So months ago, when we were still in, this is pre-debate season, I'm looking at all the things that was done for the people that were there. I said, you know, the people I like most, if I was to make president, vice president, this is not reality, this is what it is. I would do Tulsi Gabbard, Andrew Yang. Tulsi Gabbard is the president, Andrew Yang, vice president. That was 6 months ago, so longer than that, 8 months ago, something like that. I came up with that. Okay. For me, that has not changed, but let's go to what's happening now. I'm just going to take the major peoples that I understand. Oh, now I got to take the glasses off so I can see. Let's just get rid of Tom Steyer right away. Tom Steyer, okay, billionaire, whatever, but he's just doing his reparation thing and have a committee on reparations. So, you know, what we could do is, you know, deal with that, right? But as far as president goes, you know, the whole climate change thing, look, the climate thing is upon us, or whatever it is upon us. People don't want to act, they just don't want to act. Him being president ain't going to change a whole bunch of stuff, right? Because, you know, there's all these forces. You got to fight a whole bunch of peoples in order to get it done. And plus, you know, this is like a... Well, anyway, so that's him, you know. And the thing is, his priority becomes our priority, you know, as far as his reparations committee goes. Okay, now I'm talking ADOS right now. So, you know, we should be talking to him. Hey, this is how you refine your reparations thing. In fact, whoever's going to be on that commission or whatever have you, then ADOS has to be on there. It should be all total ADOS. So those are the kind of things you have to negotiate for, okay? Let me go to, let me get real. I call this the Elizabeth Klobuchar. Elizabeth Klobuchar, You get it. If you don't get it, it's all right. So we ain't going to talk about them, okay? They're off the board. Now, Marianne Williamson just dropped out, but she threw her weight behind Andrew Yang, which is an interesting thing because that's good. In fact, we should be using that because she was full of reparations. She understood the whole ADUS thing. So she almost should be another a voice for us to let Andrew Yang understand that if she's going to put her weight behind him so she can have a discussion with him on that kind of issue, okay? Hopefully. We'll see what happens. So she's out, but Andrew Yang is still there, which is kind of an interesting thing, too. One thing I noticed about Andrew Yang, aside from the energy he expels, is that everybody likes him. I'm talking about all the politicians, the press. They tried to, you know, sideline him for a bit, but you know, everybody still likes him. He's not unlikable. This is interesting. Let me keep on going. I'm gonna get rid of this. So, but for me, in reality, what happens with Andrew Yang? My problem with Andrew Yang, his foreign policy is like terrible. I'm sitting here in Africa, so I'm gonna tell you, it's just bad. Right? I don't know where he's getting foreign policy stuff from, but. I don't particularly like it. His whole other stuff is kind of really, really interesting. The thing I like most about him, everybody goes with the $1,000 a month. We'll get to that in a second. But this whole other stuff, the same thing with that Tulsi Gabbard is looking for. This electoral reform is what we're talking about. You know, he has what's called, he's calling democracy dollars that he used only for elections. So this gets rid of all your lobbyist kind of situation, your big donors, whatever. So everybody has a certain amount of money to spend to put into a campaign called democracy dollars. It can only be for that campaign, for that kind of thing. That is an interesting idea. It's much more, so that's still part of electoral reform. And then with Tulsi's got a whole bunch of electoral reform stuff too. So we really got to get this voting thing right and stuff and you know, get these machines, all that stuff. That's got to be sorted out. So he'd be good for that. In fact, if I was let me keep on going. So Andrew Yang has that. Biden, I just put bye-bye Biden. If you want to waste your time with Biden, this will just waste your time with Biden. Tulsi, interesting. Tulsi, here's the thing about Tulsi Gabbard, for me. This is why I say Tulsi for president, Andrew Yang for vice president. For me, Tulsi Gabbard, everybody has their issues, right? We would be reparations, you know, so that's one of my issues, right? Climate change, my thing is evident. If you don't want to deal with it, that it's got to be a collective thing, honey, not just one government, whatever. So I don't have to, I'm not worried about, I'm not, that's not one of my issues, right? Of course, Medicare for all, not my issue. I'm a veteran. I'm in a VA system, so I got Medicare for all, right? In fact, the way I got my life right now, all my medical stuff I deal in the States, and then just my dental I deal here in South Africa. Ta-da! So that's not an issue for me. So what is the issue for me with Tulsi? It's this whole war thing. This dismantling, these wars. To me, that's the most important thing. You know, I don't care. It's the most important thing because our money that we spend on war is our money that we're spending on war. That's the point, you know. That money could be spent other ways, including reparations. You see? Okay. Also, I think she's the only one who has the gumption, the guts to stay. She proves that she can stand up to the military industrial complex. That's what we got going here. It's not the military. We got the politicians in there. Military, right? Industrial, that's the finance, right? And then you got, that's right, the politicians. That's, yeah. It's terrible. So for me, that's the whole thing because, so that's where I look at it now. Now, that's my fantasy, whatever it is. In reality, if I was to go, you say, well, you haven't mentioned Bernie. How come you haven't mentioned Bernie? Well, here's the thing. Bernie, to me, is still a politician. When I say a politician, he's all about the compromise. He's all about the capitulation. So I can't deal with capitulation and compromise. One of the things I loathe about Barack Obama, he's a capitulator. He's still a capitulator. So I'm not into capitulators. I come from the South Bronx, man. You got to bring it. I mean, it's like you come with your manhood. You don't compromise your manhood before you get in the fight. Before the fight, you don't say, oh, I think maybe. No. See, this is what I couldn't stand about Barack Obama and his, he didn't even have a henchman. What's the head of the justice guy, the Eric Holder? He was supposed to be his henchman. He wasn't even a henchman for Barack. He wasn't a henchman for black people. He wasn't a henchman for nobody. Well, he's a henchman for the banking system, which he's back in. So anyway, so here's the way I think it works out, right? Bernie goes back to the Senate. I don't know wherever Bernie goes, right? He's a politician. Don't worry, I know Bernie's going to win. That's not what I'm talking about. So anyway, so what happens is, in reality, Bernie's president. He has Tulsi as his vice president, which is fine because she can handle the military stuff and the foreign stuff, which is what a vice president usually does. The vice president does more of the foreign stuff, traveling around to foreign places and stuff like that, you know? So that's good for that. So Tulsi takes care of, she's the tie-breaking thing in the Senate, whatever have you. She's in there dealing with all the military stuff, dealing with the foreign affairs stuff. Perfect. Vice president, perfect for her, right? Andrew Yang, you know, he couldn't be my president because people ain't, don't, you know, I don't know why they're not, whatever they're going to do, right? But he becomes part of a cabinet or something deep in the cabinet, be education, be health, something, because that he's got a lot of ideas. Let me go to Andrew Yang there. Let me just talk about ADOS for just a second. See, my whole thing, ADOS is supposed to be politics. Okay, let me give you one political point that I would put instead of just everybody will jump on and you're, oh, how are you going to get the $1,000 a month? How are you going to do this? What you going to do that? Or maybe ADOS, he hasn't really, that reparation, that $1,000 gives everybody. He hasn't really talked about reparation. He's going to study commission, blah, blah, blah. The whole thing that they say about it. I would come up to Andrew Yang and say, yo, Brother Yang, here's the deal. You got this $1,000 you want to give away a month, right? I'm with that, right? To everybody, right? But here's the thing. Now, remember, you started this. When you started this thing, you remember you got some $1,000, let's call R&D, development money going around the country. You got certain people that's living off this $1,000. You gave them $1,000 a month, and that's what they're living off. You give these stories about how they're doing, playing the guitar, this and whatever, doing that, and paying debts, whatever. Great. I say for ADOS, here's the deal. What happens? Yes, we get the $1,000 a month, like everybody else. However, you say, hey, let's test something out because these people have been done wrong. So for reparations, this is not the reparations, but I just want to test something out. So what I would do, this is Yang speaking, or we're speaking to Yang. So here's what you do, Yang. What you do is our $1,000 a month is also we get a debt jubilee. Right? If you're ADOS, this is a debt jubilee. So your debts are all wiped out. Student debt, whatever the debt is, you wiped out. Debt jubilee for ADOS. It's part of reparation. We're still getting $1,000 a month. We got a debt jubilee. So now we don't have to spend that $1,000 a month on paying our debt. So we're a special group in that. You see? Just start with that. See, we just want to see how it works. And since we got this group ADOS, we can test it on them, you know, giving them $1,000 a month, plus there's a debt jubilee for them. Boom, boom, boom. That's how I would deal with Yang, and that's how I would deal with politics as it was. Yeah, this is one of the things I didn't want to really do this thing right now. I just went through my whole primary thing, how I'm one of them. In fact, I got to get back to states because my Virginia, we have absentee ballot before, or early voting before, but I think the primaries come up in June, so I have to be back by the states by June. So that's when I'll be. Okay. Then I thought to join my ADOS brothers in New York, you know, Brooklyn, whatever have you. And you know, that's won't work out of that because easier because I'll be in New York, Virginia, blah 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 blah. Okay, great. Now here's the thing that I find super duper interesting. Yvette did a commentary this morning here, well, last night, I guess, on Monday night for you guys, because Joe Rogan, they said Joe Rogan endorsed Bernie Sanders. Well, yeah, it's not really what happened. And then Yvette goes on about Bernie, she doesn't know Joe Rogan. Actually, she does. I've listened to her. She said, I listened to a few things. You got to listen to Joe Rogan. No, Joe Rogan, he's the most difficult person if you ever want to try to label this, that. And you can't call him no racist or nothing like that. Because in this show, just look at his guests. Guests you never see. All kinds of things. He's truly, what podcasts is a definition of, not this agenda stuff. And what I really like about Joe Rogan, I like Joe Rogan. I listen to Joe Rogan. But one of the things is that what I appreciate about Joe Rogan is, remember, I'm a radio man. I've been interviewing people for a long time, since the 70s, right? Since my college radio program. Joe Rogan does it right. In an interview, you come in, we have some knowledge to present, and then you're trying to have a conversation. He usually only has one-on-one conversations, right? You don't have a panel of people. You know, sometimes he has three, maybe it's three people in there, but usually it's just one person. So you're learning stuff. You see, as he's learning, you're learning. That's really what I love about Joe Rogan. So for him to pull, so for people to start pulling out, well, he's this, he's that. Well, he may be this, he may be that, but you point that out, you're stupid. You're stupid and uninformed. You fight with Joe if you want, but let me tell you what happened. Actually, what happened, Joe Rogan did not, if technically, how do you say, endorse Bernie Sanders. What happened, he was having a conversation, like a conversation, and somebody, well, who would you want to, who do you are leaning towards, whatever it is. He said, well, I'm liking Bernie Sanders. And he went to this whole thing, I'm liking Bernie Sanders and da-da-da-da. So, yeah, I would vote for Bernie. You know what I mean? Because, remember, he has Tulsi on there. He really likes Tulsi. He had Andrew Yang on. And Bernie, you know? Other than that, he hasn't had anybody else. I don't think Marianne. Did Marianne call out? I have to check, see if Marianne Williams with it. Anyway, so that's it. There's other people trying to get on Joe Rogan, but get out of here. Because he's not political. I mean, he's not political. He's not interested in that. He's got too many things other to do. So anyway, so I'm just saying that what I realize is that if you don't follow people, really follow them, if you just this cast or that cast, you don't know what's going on. You really don't, and you should refrain from commenting. So I got to say, refrain from commenting. So let me stop here. I want to refrain from commenting here. I just wanted to give you this little update what I feel about what's happening with the election. We'll see what happens. Da, da, da. People, it don't make no sense now. Let them keep on talking what they're talking. But we really need to get on it and leave Joe Rogan. Oh, by the way, I did write a comment in the cast in the Breaking Brown, you know, cast that thing. Did. One thing I said that early about this is like last year. This is like middle, more than the middle. This is like maybe March, April, last, whenever it was. I had suggested. Antonio had put up a posting, and in his posting, I wrote an email. And I suggested that, you know, he should, you know, this issue should be taken up with Joe Rogan. You know, he should be on Joe Rogan. And he wrote me an email back, said, well, he's been on Joe Rogan for the Rick Ross whatever thing. But that's all he said. See, let me tell you something. Because, you know, you better not be jumping on elves. Here's the way a true elf works. I said, well, perhaps you should be on Joe Rogan. That's just a suggestion, right? He calls about, I've been on Joe Rogan for his Rick Ross thing. Now, hitting in there, say, well, if you've been there for Rick Ross, that means you know, and you're in Los Angeles, he's in Los Angeles, why don't you just talk to him? You just get on the cast. Talk about ADLs. He'll talk to you if you have a relationship with already. So instead of jumping and saying, oh, Joe is this, or he's that, or you're following the headlines, whatever have you, talk to the man. Especially Antonio, did y'all talk about, you can talk about sports, da, da, da. You're supposed to be a sports person, da, da, da. So yeah, hey, so there you go. Culture, he's the culture, well, culture, you know, low culture, look, when I say low, I mean like comedians, that's not low culture. My point is, he should be talking to, you know, it's simple. Okay, so that's my suggestion, and that's all I have to say. Me from here, from me T from the Patterson taking the train to the bed here it's an ADOS reality, letting you know what I only suspect about the current election.